For this module, we can begin by looking at signal peptide detection. So signal peptide detection is done using a software algorithm which is called a signal P3.0 server.
Okay.
So all you have to do is copy and paste your sequence in this server window in the GUI and it will predict your signal peptide. The next aspect which you should focus on is your genetic code. Now you must be aware of the usage of codon. So the usage of codon varies from host to host and from organism to organism. This is a standard E. coli codon usage table. However, if you need to express a gene from plants in E. coli, you will have to modify the codon.
Okay.
Now, in the earlier days, this was not possible because of there was no advanced methods such as synthetic biology.
Okay.
In today's context, like in today's environment, we basically deliver the amino acid sequence to the service provider and they will translate, change the codons for the specific host. We have to specify, we state that this amino acid sequence is derived from plant and we want to express it in E. coli. They will modify the codon using an algorithm and then synthesize the whole gene. So in the current context, this problem has been solved. Generally, E. coli had this problem that it could not understand certain codons which were which are in a very low concentration in its cytosol. Of course, it does have all the codons, but they are present at a lower concentration. The tRNAs for those codons are present at a lower concentration. So you don't get those proteins expressed, or sometimes you get a wrongly inserted amino acid which will change the entire protein.
Okay.
So codon usage is important. And we have different translation tables. So number one is the standard table. It's a generalized table, which is a consensus table. And mitochondrial DNA has different codon as compared to bacterial DNA. Even though mitochondrial DNA is posited to be of bacterial origin, the mitochondria was engulfed by a eukaryotic cell, the codon usage is entirely different. So mitochondrial genes, when you transfer them for expression in E. coli, you have to modify codons significantly. Okay, now if you didn't have an E. coli system, you can still express the protein in vitro.
In vitro, okay.
The way this is done is you take your same plasmid, you take your gene construct containing your E. coli as I described earlier, and you have an E. coli lysate. So you receive this lysate which contains the ribosomes and everything else required for translation of the protein. The lysate is mixed with your plasmid. So it's a cell-free system. The E. coli are not growing. It's basically E. coli which have been lysed and you get a lysate. And then they will express the protein because it's taking place in vitro. You don't have to have a living system. However, this system can only be used to express protein at a very, very low concentration for diagnostic or laboratory usage. In order to go in for the large scale preparation, you still go back to in vivo. Okay. Let me summarize the process. So this is the process. So the first step, as I explained earlier, is the design of the genes with specific primers with an intact ORF. Today we can replace that with synthetic biology. So the first and second step are replaced with synthetic biology. The third step is ligation of this gene onto the vector. In today's scenario, all these three steps are done using synthetic biology. So the vector is basically provided by the service provider. For instance, IDT or First Base. You can ask them for a vector and you can match your gene with the vector.
Okay.
So we receive, what we receive in our lab is basically a gene construct with a vector and the gene of interest as well.
Already.
So this is good for production. However, if you want to study gene expression and you want to study different combinations, it's always good to resort to the older way of PCR
the one
and ligation.
That we discussed this now, right?
Yeah. But for the case of industrial expression, you just clone and design a gene using a service provider. Then you transform it into the host, you induce expression, and you purify and analyze your protein, refold and characterize. Okay. So the first step is isolation of the gene of interest. So when you need to isolate your gene of interest, you need to go back to your database, design primers, and isolate the intact open reading frame.
But what is de novo? I forgot already.
Okay, de novo synthesis is when you, for instance, the protein does not exist in nature. and by your experimentation you decided to express a hypothetical protein based on your study. So you created a synthetic amino acid construct, and then that's basically de novo. You created a de novo protein.
It means it doesn't exist. It's just
it doesn't exist in nature, but you have created out of your computational output. So you computed, for instance, you know that you have this sequence of hydrophobic amino acids and this insertion of hydrophilic amino acids, and then you have it together and you can translate it into a protein, then you basically have a synthetic construct. So that's de novo approach. Whereas the other approach is based on a rational design in which you have for instance, you have two subunits of a protein and you fuse them together and then the function changes. So you have some a priori knowledge.
But the de novo, we don't know the function, right, Doctor? We just create it. When we insert it, it can be
different. That's why, because of advances in computational biology, you can design new proteins which don't exist in nature but which have certain function. It can be entirely new. The reason why researchers are adopting this model is because when you have a de novo synthesized protein, you can directly apply for intellectual property protection.
Okay.
So you design something de novo, it has no prior art, so you can. Whereas when you design a protein with prior art, means two enzyme domain, you fuse together and you get a third enzyme which has dual function. So then you have used a rational design approach. But the first step is to isolate your gene of interest. Okay, so in this case, you can refer back to the gene bank, isolate, download a sequence and design a primer. Okay, so you have your nucleotide sequence, as we discussed in bioinformatics, and you have your design of specific primers. So once you design your primers, you can order them and basically isolate your gene of interest and ligate it onto your vector. The third step is basically to ensure that your open reading frame is intact.
Okay. Doctor, the open reading frame is a sequence.
It's right? A sequence.
The DNA sequence.
Yeah.
Okay.
So the open reading frame has to be intact in terms of each codon triplet has to encode the amino acid, and when you assemble all the amino acids together, they should represent your desired protein.
Okay.
So if you shift the open reading frame, for example, +1, you shift it slightly, the entire amino acid
composition will change.
It will change.
Doctor, the genomic sequence, then we translate into the codons, is it?
Yeah, you translate into codons.
The software will do?
You can do it manually as well using the codon usage table, or you can do it using software. So the first step is to ensure that it is intact, because E. coli will not express any gene which does not have an open reading frame that is intact. You miss out a single nucleotide, you will not have expression.
How we want to make sure it's already intact?
Okay. So once you have your gene sequence, you basically use this tool. So you have expressive proteomic server, and then you have a translate tool. There are many tools available. This is available online, and it's GUI, graphic user interface. You copy and paste your sequence in this tool, and it will predict your amino acid sequence. So you know, for instance, certain things, like you have to focus on ensuring that you do not have, for instance, too many methionine codons or ATGs inside, otherwise you will have premature start. Or if you have too many stop codons for that particular organism, you have premature stop. Okay, so you should ensure that those ATGs...
ATG is the start codon.
Right? ATG, AUG. In RNA, it's AUG. And then your termination sequences. So you should identify your terminator sequences for that particular host. Okay. Sometimes it may also be the RNA. Sometimes the RNA will form a secondary structure, and you will have a problem with the expression as well. Okay. So this is the rule of three. You divide your...
Okay, is the substrate of protein sequence similar to the... We have to check.
You need to check that before. Or else you will order a protein which will... You'll have order a gene which will be encoding a protein which is not the one which you need. Then you do primer synthesis, or in this case, gene synthesis. You amplify the gene of interest. You ligate onto the appropriate expression vector. This is where your matching of the vector and the host comes into play. Then you have your basic expression vector with the promoter, your gene of interest, the origin of replication, and your selection marker. In this case, it's antibiotic. And you transform into the host using heat shock for chemically competent.
Same like cloning also, right?
Okay. Yeah, same. This step is similar. You ligate, you clone, you transform. Okay, and then you screen for transformants.
Is this the gene of interest we change into the codons? Only that, right, doctor?
You don't change the gene of interest into codon. You basically use the DNA sequence which will be translated into codon.
Only that, right?
Yeah,
the
only
others
that.
Are same.
The rest of them are similar except for the promoter sequences.
Only the promoter sequences.
The terminator sequence, and you need to attach maybe a fusion partner, a tag, affinity tag.
Okay.
So these things are different.
Only the promoter sequence, there are extra, which is promoter sequence and also the terminator sequence.
Yeah.
Which is in cloning, we don't have it.
We don't have those because we don't express protein. We are basically cloning or copying DNA.
Okay.
So this is the IPTG. So this is a sugar analog. So when you basically induce E. coli with this, they will start expressing the protein by a cascade. So finally, your protein has to be quantified. So in the earlier days, we used STS phage, and we used a temporal STS phage, which means that we took out protein at different times. Okay, for instance, prior to induction with IPTG, we took a sample from the flask. And then we spin down and we extract the protein. Then we do 1 hour induce, and 1 hour, 2 hour, 3 hour, and 24 hours.
Induce of the IPTG.
Induce using IPTG.
Okay.
Then we check. And we should, by logic, we should get a protein spot which increases with time. It's a temporal expression.
So it means the protein will be more and more.
Yeah. So that's a verification that the protein is being expressed. It's not a native protein from E. coli. It's basically an expressed protein.
But you can't quantify the numbers. You cannot.
You can quantify it using Bradford assay.
Oh, okay.
You can quantify the protein with Bradford assay or densitometry. So you have your protein. In this case, you can see, for instance, 1 will represent the uninduced and 2 will represent the induction, and then 3, 4, 5, and 6, and 7 will be different time scales. So you can see the protein band, the size of the band actually increases.
Yes.
However, the other bands are almost constant. So the background proteins which you see are derived from E. coli.
Okay.
The one, your protein of interest is the one which is increasing.
Okay.
Okay, one of the ways you can predict the protein is truly your protein is by using antibodies. If your protein has antibody target, you can basically target that protein with antibody tag, and it will bind to that protein, and then you can wash the gel off, and you can basically get evidence that your protein is truly your protein of interest, because antibody antigen interaction is specific, protein specific. Okay, the next one is purifying of your protein. So you can fuse a partnering tag to your protein, usually at the N terminal, amino terminal end. This can be the histidine tag or the glutathione S transferase tag. Okay, GST tag and NINT. So you basically have your his tag, and you will purify the protein through a column which will specifically have an affinity for the GST tag.
Okay.
The rest of the proteins from E. coli will flow through. Later on, when you want to release your protein from the column after you have washed it, you can change the column conditions either by changing the pH or the electrolyte composition, and you'll have the protein released from the column. So this is the way you purify the protein. So then you will ask me what happens to the tag. So after you recover your protein, you have to cleave the tag. Usually there is an enzyme cleavage site between the tag protein and your target protein. Usually we have, for instance, we got the TEV protease, because it's a tobacco H virus protease. You can treat that tag with that TEV protease. It will only cleave that specific site and not the other proteins.
Oh.
It will cleave off the tag. Or you can, in the case of 6X histag, we have the enterokinase site. You treat the fusion with enterokinase, it will cleave off. So you'll have your target protein, and your tag will be, you can wash off because it's a small protein.
So when we wash, the tag will be removed?
Yeah, the tag will be removed because the tag is a small protein. You can separate it again using column. So you asked me about recombinant protein solubility. So in many cases, the protein in E. coli, in a majority of cases, the protein will be in insoluble form. However, in some cases, it will be in soluble format. So, in order to predict this, we have a recombinant protein solubility prediction calculator.
Oh.
It's a calculator. So it's from the University of Oklahoma. It's a very good tool. So you feed in your amino acid sequence, you key in, and it will predict your percentage of insolubility. So in this case, it has a 65.7% chance of insolubility. When
so it means it should be in the pellet.
It should be in the pellet. Now you know why we use this calculator. You can, so it will be in the pellet and not in the soluble
form. How do you develop this kind of calculator?
Oh, it's very simple. It's based on the hydrophobicity and hydrophilicity of each amino acid.
Okay.
It's very simple calculation. So if you have a large number of amino acids which are hydrophilic,
then the
they will go into the solvent state. Okay. And finally, you have to refold your protein. So refolding your protein is the part which requires a lot of optimization.
Refolding into the nature forms, is it, doctor?
So your protein will be in two forms. One will be misfolded. One will be aggregates. Aggregates meaning two or more protein all clumped together as aggregate. So the first, the principle of protein folding is you first need to linearize the protein or render it linear. So you treat it with a like 4-molar urea, which is a very strong denaturant, and you linearize your protein.
Okay.
However, you have to ensure that you have anti-proteases as well, because when you have a bacterial protein lysate, you will have proteases from the E. coli host as well, which will try to render the protein null by degrading it. So you need to have anti-proteases inside your, and then you have your urea. So urea is the major constituent of the denaturant. So it'll denature your protein, linearize it, and then in order to refold it, you dilute out the urea using dialysis. So the hypothesis is that when you dilute out the urea, right, it will try and restore its native state.
But how we want to make sure it folded into the native state?
Because by virtue of the efflorescence dogma and the amino acid composition, the amino acid should fold into their native state. It's happening in nature all the time. Proteins have memory based on the amino acid, right? So certain amino acids have certain residues. Now, when you refold it, you should ensure that the refolding procedure is done very slowly. So you do the dialysis at very slow rate. Oh, you reduce the temperature, so your folding kinetics change.
Okay,
you must remember, although the E. coli is alive, the proteins are actually physical entities. They have a dynamic folding mechanism. So if you folded them too rapidly, they will misfold again. If you folded them too slowly, they may form aggregates again. So you need to figure that out. That's why the optimization procedure for refolding involves different dialysis times as well as different temperatures. And
so
maybe
we have to test and error, like try and error a lot of
Yeah, things. It's always trial and error. And we add DTT or dithiotriol, which will facilitate the process of folding as well in the media. So you have to develop your own mixture for refolding your buffer.
Yeah. How to check, doctor, after we done this one, how to check whether it's already back into the nature form or
activity. Purely on the basis of activity. For instance, if you had an enzyme, you expressed a cellulase in E. coli, you need to isolate the protein, refold, and then check the specific activity of that enzyme using the substrate.
If it's after we treat it with urea, 4-molar of urea, it's become aggregate again.
It will not aggregate, it will linearize, because urea will denature it completely.
But let's say we make it rapid. So doctor said there's chances.
If you do it too rapidly, it will aggregate again.
So we can check, is it?
Yeah, you can check for aggregation. You have certain tools. We have a machine in our lab which can basically predict aggregation.
Oh, okay. We have tools
to check. But at the end of the day, for an industrial setting or biotechnological context, the end product should be biologically active, which you do by testing with the enzyme substrate. Sometimes misfolded proteins also are biologically active.
Then how we are to separate it, doctor?
You cannot. You basically get the end product. Your end product. If you really want to see a protein structure, you'll have to go back down to X-ray crystallography. And you'll have to do XRD of your protein.
It's very complicated than DNA, doctor.
Because protein, but the utility of DNA is not as much as protein. Proteins have a industrial application.
Because protein is the final product, right, doctor?
Yeah. So protein need to, for example, certain enzyme may be folded by E. coli. Lipases, for example, lipases you can produce in E. coli. They are used in detergents.
Okay.
So these are all produced in E. coli and they are perfectly normal.
Anyone is doing protein work here also, be alright?
Yeah, they are. Dr. Chayu is doing protein work.
Oh, Dr. Chayu is doing.
So it's a very good field to be in. So this is your process flowchart to recap. So you have the, you first isolate your gene of interest. Secondly, you ligate onto the cloning expression mm-hmm. vector. Transform, screen, induce gene expression and purify your protein. So at every stage, things can go wrong, and this is what you have to factor into your experimental design. For instance, when you isolate your gene of interest, the gene of interest may be incompatible with E. coli.
Okay.
So we cannot predict incompatibility. Theoretically, we can predict it, but in reality, we cannot predict.
And also, we have to make sure it can divide it by 3.
Yeah, that is one factor, but sometimes we have incompatibility. For example, sometimes the RNA transcript produced by the gene of interest in E. coli may actually down-regulate certain processes in E. coli.
Oh.
So we need to take that into account. Sometimes they may have palindromic sequences. So your RNA transcript comes out and it folds on itself because it has compatibility between the 5' and 3'. In that case, you don't have protein expression. Those are things which can go wrong, which you cannot predict. You can basically view them in theory, but we cannot predict what will go wrong in the E. coli, which is a living model. When you transform, you may have compatibility between host and plasmid, which may they may be incompatible.
Okay.
And then when you screen for transformants, you are likely to pick up sometimes bacteria which do not carry plasmids. But of course, that's a minor aspect. The major aspect is toxicity of the protein to the host. Some of the proteins which are expressed in E. coli may be toxic to the host, they will basically kill off the.
Oh, okay.
In that case, you won't get transformants.
Yeah, we won't have anything.
You won't have anything. So then you have to go back to your design board and redesign your gene. So this involves a lot of effort, which is why when you get a successfully expressed gene, it actually has a large IP value. So it's clear about the process of expression.
It's clear because it's similar to the cloning.
Yeah.
It's only that they have extra things to be added in the vector.
Yeah, that's all. So that's the procedure.
And also the way we quantify is different than the DNA.
Yeah, DNA is quantified spectrophotometrically. Protein is quantified using Bradford assay.
Mm-hmm.
Which is also a colorimetric method. You can also assess proteins using the A280 okay. absorbance at 280 nanometers.
Oh, okay.
You can use that because A260 is for DNA, right? And then A280 is for protein. You can utilize
A260, 260, 280. Yeah.
So if you have used the ectoprime, you will notice that there is a UV vis spectrophotometer at the end, which will basically measure the absorbance of the eluate. The flow through is, so when the flow through has a high concentration of protein at A280, it will record a peak in our ectoprime system. So that's about it for protein expression.